Niles Public Library Board Meeting at 7:01 on October 21st, 2015. We do pledge allegiance. Oh, wait, we have to do a roll first, I'm sorry, roll. I'm moving forward too fast. Roll.
Karen Diamond.
Here.
Carolyn.
Here.
Jeanette.
Here.
Bradrock.
Here.
Kim.
Here.
Linda.
Here.
And Tim.
Tim has a medical emergency.
Oh, okay, sorry.
So, we can do a pledge allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, so I would just have a few comments. I would like to just take a few minutes to address trustee Jerblick's funding concerns within the October 14th Niles Journal and clarify the issues for any community members, virtual or here. Before I address any of the issues in question, I would like to recap to our board members, staff, and community that trustee Jerblick voted to approve the board, I mean the budget, 6-1. As president, I always make sure that everyone has a voice for discussion or any concerns. As everyone, I really believe that everyone's opinion is valued. And I really do believe in that, and I think everyone's opinion is important. So, with this brought up, it was really shocking to me that the discussion wasn't discussed here at the board table. And it was put within a letter to the editor in the journal. So, trustee Mathias also had questions after the passing of the budget, and all were answered without hesitation. So, and I appreciate that, I want everyone's questions answered. So, as a reminder, the budget was presented in May and passed in August, which has been the same schedule as in the past. This was plenty of time for any board member or community member to voice any questions or concerns. There is no hidden agenda or fast pass, it was May, June, July, August. This is not fast or rushed. If you have a question, please ask it. That's all I say, ask for questions. Another issue and question is the staff party. Jerblick implies that it was paid for. It was implied underhanded when it was voted on and approved by the board through trustee line item, but it was approved by the board. So if there's any questions, it really should be not for the administration, it should be for the board that was there at the time. So there was, there should be no question because it was approved. So another issue was the bylaw change. To clarify this, this was not a change, it was not quote-unquote deceiving the public about IMRF, unquote. It was a vote to change the bylaws back to its original verbiage because bylaws, according to a legal dictionary definition, are supposed to be rules and regulations enacted by an association to provide a framework for its operation and management. There's no place in bylaws to have specific items stated within. So it wasn't a bylaw change, it was a bylaw reversal back to the original verbiage. So another issue I would like to address is our new best practice of not signing checks at a meeting. Not all board members can, oh, excuse me, now, all board members can fully focus on agenda items. We are transparent, we have checks and balances, as both trustees Spadoni and Nakanishi review the backup, and Jeanette also is very diligent, as this is one of her strengths. You always bring up questions, and they're always answered. So please know we are very diligent, take our finances and spending serious. There are checks and balances in place, and spending is reviewed monthly. Finally, may I applaud our staff, as we are award-winning, both as a staff and as a at a library level. We even have been mentioned in the Chicago Tribune about the great events and practices our staff nurtures. Our budget reflects the committee's needs, or the community's needs, and our matrix consultant shortfall findings. Our staff's integrity and passion are in the right place. As a board, we should be library advocates, question at the table, not as a public attack. We all do our best for our Niles Public Library. Transparency, accountability, and responsible spending, we are all in. I believe the staff members are in, and we, as a board, we are all in this. There's no longer an us and them board. Let's be their advocates to let them do their jobs that we hired them for. We appreciate all that they do, and we want to earn more awards. Don't make the staff or community question our motive, as the only motive is to be the best library we can be for everyone. So, thank you for your time.
May I respond? I may not respond. You're inaccurate.
What is my inaccuracy?
That you said the budget process was the same amount of time as it's always been in the past. Because we've sat in a board meeting and tried to squeeze it through for a couple of months is not the same process as actually having a meeting separate from this board meeting, discussing the entire budget line by line, reviewing spending, reviewing purchases, what's the anticipation for the, there's an entire process involved in budgeting, spending, and it certainly is not sitting at this table. But that was my concern, that was why I brought it up. But thank you for your opinion.
Thank you.
As far as the party goes, it was not clear to us. We were giving the employees $50 gift cards. I have nothing against the employees. No one ever said our employees weren't the best. Our position always was you cannot use tax dollars for parties. And that was not clear at all. That's why we were alarmed. There was so much discussion about this when she noticed it in under the trust aid account. So yes, it was brought to your attention or to everyone's attention at that time. And as far as check processing goes, or the review of checks, mm-hmm. it's a very detailed process. No better time to review checks than when everybody's here. And that they're just automatically printed at some other time. Just reading the register isn't enough. You really need time. And I don't see that time being allotted any longer. It's quite a bit of money just writing out checks.
The time is allotted.
That's just my opinion. And then as far as the matrix findings go, we have yet to review them and implement them. It's at least 15 pages long. After the process was finalized, we thanked him, he left, we've never looked at it. We spent all that money, we are not taking advantage of a consultant who came in and gave us incredible feedback. And that's all I have to say.
Thank you.
And I have one.
Thank you. Yeah, what's next?
Okay, my concern here, can I understand your opinion? And I respect your opinion. But from my observations, when you were doing checks, were you really focusing on what else was going on in the meeting?
Always. Always. I spent hours
preparing. Why is it that we always ask things that had, we all who were focusing heard to repeat it if you were paying so much attention?
You need to realize spending is our number one priority.
Oh, I totally agree with you.
All the conversations around this table, if you check out those videos, there's less organization in these meetings than there is in the structure of a kindergarten class. There's so much back comments and side comments. It's outrageous.
Really?
Yeah. Have you viewed them? And then the little secrets everyone's, I mean, we're adults telling secrets. Check out these videos. Check out the video. You've got to see yourself on the video. It's amazing.
If I don't tell secrets, if anything, I go like this.
Well, I think it's very unprofessional. But that's what goes on.
If that's what's wrong because I'm covering my face,
okay.
Well, then
right.
So be it.
Okay.
I'm sorry to offend you.
Mark, please.
I'm the new secretary here, and Tim Spadoni and I get the checks by email from Greg at least a week in advance. And that gives us the time to go over them thoroughly. We don't have to come in here and sign 100 checks and have one try to listen with another ear to what's going on at the meeting. I don't think that works very well. I think that the new system works much better because if there's a question, we bring it up to Greg and he'll answer the question and then we go from there. Those checks don't go out until there's a check and balance system here in place that it's very effective.
Well, you're also preventing the rest of the board from being privy to all these conversations and what's going on.
Okay.
Because all we get to do is look at it as a
Carolyn,
check register.
Carolyn?
That's all right. She's
Jeanette's next.
Line.
Go ahead.
All right, just one question. When you get the checks, though, do you get all the backup with it?
if we have a question, we can...
But you said you get the check. I mean, you can look at the check register, so instead of emailing every check, you have the check register.
Right.
So there should be no reason...
We have access to the file here. Greg showed it to us when we first elected our positions.
Because I've checked that box.
We have access to that, so that we can either go through, for the, look through the, through that file for the backup, or Greg will help us do that.
Right, I, okay, I understand. I understand that, because I checked that box monthly. This is, I think, the first time I haven't checked.
Same thing we're doing.
But the Christmas, I'm going to let it drop, enough's enough. But I guess I have to see the notes, because I just want to be on record to say I would have never approved a $5,000 on taxpayer money when taxpayers are lucky they can eat, buy medication, pay their mortgage. No way would I have allowed it. So I guess I need to see the discussion of minutes that saying I approved this Christmas party. But, you know, as of now, it's closed. And regarding the budget, until I see the minutes. And then regarding the budget, Linda, you've been on this, and Karen, and we've been on this board a lot. We've had special meetings, budget meetings. You cannot discuss a budget at a meeting like tonight and go and get an accurate, come and accurate answers. We'd be here till 2:00 in the morning if we didn't done that. So we need to review a budget, no. I mean, we have to, a special meeting, at least a couple special meetings should be called to review the budget. But I was the no vote on the budgets.
Colleen, may I just state?
Thank you.
There was so much cross-conversation, and I know it's too late to do anything about it. I was voting to decrease the $150,000 that Ms. Lemke was in need of for new staff, $75,000. I totally missed if you were voting on the budget and that. So yes, you got my vote, but it'll never happen again. Because before I vote, I will ask, what are we voting on? So that's why you got my vote.
So I'd like to entertain a motion to move the consent agenda to approve... Okay, to approve the consent agenda.
So moved.
Seconded.
Is there any... A, approve the revised minutes of the regular board meeting of August 19th, 2015. B, approve the minutes of the regular board meeting of September 16th, 2015. C, approve the payment of the bills for operating expenses of $220,115.51. Payroll expenses of $268,425.28. Special reserve expenses of $6,651. For a total monthly expense of $505,191.79.
I have additional comments for the August minutes that were left out. We talked about it last month, and I was, it was suggested I bring them to this meeting and give them to Diane. They're pretty much all my comments, except for one of the taxpayers. I wrote, Mrs. Myrna Zaleski asked if there was a decrease in printed books, and e-books are used more, why is there not a decrease in expenses? That was the only comment I did not see in the original August minutes. And then there were a few things that I had stated but weren't in the minutes, so I have them here.
My understanding from the Open Meetings Act training that we just did is that these minutes must be approved at this meeting, so...
Well, they can. I'm ready.
The board will need to know what your comments are.
Okay, my comments were page 7, paragraph 4. It was regarding my attendance at the Open Communities Justice Project. It wasn't clear exactly what it was about, so I just wanted to make sure if it's going in the minutes that we do it accurately. I put Trustee Derblick attended the Open Communities Justice Project along with Niles Human Relations Commissioner Joe Cuffell. The purpose of this event is to promote fair housing and social justice within our communities. Our role is to provide an information table explaining our role in the community regarding welcoming all residents, including services we provide. On behalf of the library, she brought literature regarding the free lunch program offered during the summer, the low vision equipment available at the library, and the success of our summer reading club volunteer program. She thanked Mr. Pritz for helping out with a last-minute display for the library. Ms. Turple thought we really stood up because of everything the library has to offer. Is there a problem with that?
Yeah, I just had a response. You know, maybe it would not be what was said, but I believe the minutes really are supposed to be a brief summary of what was said, not a verbatim recital of everything that was said at a meeting. Certainly, if any member of the public wants to hear exactly what any person said, they can listen or actually watch the video that's being recorded right now. I believe that under the open the minutes really just have to be a brief summary of what was said and not an actual verbatim recital of what every person said.
And it wasn't. They have to be inaccurate, I believe. Is that what our attorney told us last week, that I asked for that in writing so we could be clear on how to write minutes? I believe it was an accurate account of the topic, or what other word did we use? And that's what I tried to do here. I said I couldn't remember the person I attended with, Joe Koppel. I think his name should be in here. I don't think this is something that we need to argue about. Our minutes do not reflect what happens in these meetings, the tone of the taxpayers that attend. You cut everything out, and I don't think that's an accurate account of what's going on. And if she's typing from a video or from a recording, I don't see what's so difficult about typing this. And if you haven't listened to the video, it'd take you 4 hours to find a statement that you may have made in these minutes, because we really need to address what we think videotaping minutes is all about. If these taxpayers want to go to that video and look at a line item, the consent agenda, they should be able to zero in on a number and just listen to those few seconds, not 3 hours worth of on and on conversation. So no, it's not that easy. We really don't have an accurate representation of our meetings.
Where exactly is that supposed to be in here?
Where is what?
It's page 10.
Page seven, paragraph four.
I think in this packet, it's page five.
Well, I'm looking at the August minutes.
Feel that I need guidance from the board as a whole as to how you want Diane to be doing these minutes, because she tried very hard in the last time that we had a lot of comments from the public to reflect them very accurately, and then she was told she put in too much. So, and she felt bad about that because she wanted to represent their comments fairly, and so she felt last month like she had been told she hadn't done a good job because she'd written too much. And so we went and looked at the village minutes, and we find that the village minutes are very much just the motion, who voted, a very brief summary of any discussion. So for this month, she has followed the structure of the village minutes. And so she really needs some guidance. I need some guidance to work with her on how much information that you, as a board as a whole, want in the minutes.
Excuse me,
Attorney
Walsh. I would like, for me, and we can go around the table, I would like exactly that, the motion, what's voted, a brief summary, and if anybody would like anything more, then they can watch our videotape. That's me. So, Danette?
I mean, that's a point, but I mean, there are, I think.
We'll readjourn at 7:50. We can do a roll.
Karen?
Here.
Carolyn?
Here.
Jeanette?
Yep.
Barbara?
Here.
Danny?
Here.
Linda?
Here.
Okay, we had ended at a public comment, so we have 5 minutes per person. We'd like you to stand up here so that you can be videotaped. We'll put the timer on for 5 minutes. And just as a reminder,
Where's my little blurb here? There we go. You say you're, you know, within your 5 minutes, and the board members will not respond to comments from speakers, but we will comment appropriately at another time, okay? So we have Jerry Skarpansky first, please. Oh, I'm sorry, Jerry. You've been waiting so patiently.
Got rid of me fast.
There you go.
Jerry Skarpansky, 6851 West Dobson and Niles, longtime Niles resident, and I'm addressing trustees, the operations executive, and the people of Niles, hopefully, so they're listening up. I've watched, since the election, I've watched every video, which is a long process. I watched everyone, and I read the minutes, which are online at the Village of Niles Library site. And believe me, many of the comments that Carolyn had are true. Even tonight, we were sitting there, we couldn't hear what was being said over here in this area. We're not here, because you guys are talking to each other. We're sitting in the back. That should be addressed. After watching these, I think Carolyn's comments on the minutes were also very accurate. You want salient points in your minutes, but you want to cover all the, you want to cover all the important points, especially those from the public, especially those. And in viewing the minutes on and videos, about 3 months ago, I believe it was, Trustee Spadoni made the comment that we should limit the amount of public comment information into the minutes. You can go back and look at the videos like I did, see how long it takes. You'll see that I'm right. You wanted to limit the amount of public comments. I think that's entirely wrong. You want to put more of the public comments in there. Okay, the tone of the meetings cannot be put in the written minutes. So you have to adjust for that by putting in the most important points. And believe me, the perception is that you're hiding things. That's the perception we get. If we don't know what's going on, we assume you're hiding things. That's just the way it is. Since the election, we trusted the previous board because of the way they conducted business. This board has to earn our trust outside of two members. Trustee Whitlick, the mayor, and the Tides. The rest have to earn their trust because, in my mind, and I'm sure a lot of the other people, we have two factions. We have the thinkers and the spenders, and everything points to it. You can review the videos, review the minutes, and you'll see what we're talking about. A budget process should be taken over time with members of the public present outside of salary information. Hasn't been done. It was done in the past, not anymore. And I believe there was comments in some of the videos to that point too, that it doesn't have to be public. Baloney. Now I'd like to address the pension. I think a lot of the people here and many of the people in Niles like to see a private life sector pension or the one that's already existent. We want no 100% guarantees on everything except principal contributed amounts. We don't want it like Chicago and Illinois. We know what's happened. It's like a burning house, these pension things. And people are trying to put water on that house to put out the flames, and you take it to the Illinois Supreme Court and they're giving them gasoline, the worst possible thing. We don't want that in Niles. We don't care what other suburbs have or what the library director wants or the people want, okay? The prisoners do not run the prison. And I think you people are forgetting that. Pension plans should be, as I said before, much like private sector plans, with the employees contributing more to the plan than the public taxpayers, not less. You got it all wrong, all wrong. If a new plan is adopted, and the way things go and the way things are hidden here, I think if a plan goes in, I think all employees should start new plan tenure on day one. The old employees stop the plan, pay them off whatever's there. If they want to be in a new plan, they start as a new employee, not an old one, not a data boy type plan. Next point is the tax levy. I'm sure that's going to come up. And like I tried to do at the meeting we were in previously, and I knew I wouldn't get an answer, by the way. I know you people aren't responsible for giving a comment or an answer back. But I just wanted to see if anybody would even attempt it. No one did. Okay, what we want... What? May I have one more minute? Thank you. This board, to do their fiduciary duties, should ask each one of yourselves and your finance person, how much will the tax levy increase the average taxpayer's taxes? Okay, the next time they get it. We need that amount. And I don't have it, I don't get it. That's your duty to tell us, not high numbers. You know, and the last one, and this is kind of a good point for the future. I think you guys really have to sit down and throw your political, and I call this very political, spenders versus non-spenders. Okay, what should a library be? I don't think there should be food at any time in a library, no babysitting, dropping off kids, no high-tech computer lab for a handful of people that are going to use it. What are schools for? Okay, what are private tech companies for? Libraries is not under a school program. And not a movie rental store either. I don't want to come in here and rent movies. If it's for instructional purposes, fine. And finally, I think this place should be a nice place to visit, which it is, but not for kids to hang out. Thank you for the extra time.
Thank you. Next is Bob.
Pelesny, that's me.
Pelesny.
Okay.
My name is Bob Pelesny. I live at 8460 Chester, and I want to make one thing perfectly clear. I'm not here tonight because I'm a soccer fan. I agree with Jerry, and I backed him up on many of the things that he said, and I'm not going to go over that. But as far as, like, I would like to talk about the article that I read as far as, like, having pensions. I don't believe in the pension program would be a good program for the library and for the people of Niles. It's going to, these things are failing left and right. They raise people's taxes. People are on the brink of what they can afford about living here. And your job is to keep it reasonable. Niles has always been a reasonable city with low taxes. And that's why I live here. That's why I want to continue living here. They have a 401k style plan from reading in the article, which is good. There's a lot of good points to it. They were bringing out bad points. They said that two-thirds of the money goes into the program, one-third the people take home with them. It doesn't get invested into their retirement plan. But that's their choice. You win the lottery, you get a choice. You can take it in a lump sum, you can take it over 20 years. It's whatever works out best for you. So that's what I feel. Yeah, that's a good program. If we need to increase it to make it a little bit better for the employees over here, yeah, let's take a look at that. But that's not going to cost us anywhere near what a pension program is going to cost years down the road for the taxpayers. They were saying that the southern suburbs doesn't have the IRMF in Schaumburg and that, but they said that theirs is a little bit higher. Well, what is that number? I'd like to know what that number is, and yeah, maybe we should meet it or beat it. I'm not here to be beating down on the employees and saying that, you know, I don't want them to have a retirement program. I believe they should. I have a small business, I have a 401k. For my employees, I've contributed up to 25% when we've had good years. When we had bad years, it's less. But we do the best we can, and the money's put into the program, and they get to choose how they want to invest it. If they want to put it in, you know, something that's going to be a little more risky, that's their choice. That's their money. They earned it. They got it. Let them take it. The other part is what I hear is they said that with the IRMF, they would sit there and go and review it periodically. I think that review would be to see how much we have to raise our tax levy. I don't agree with that. I like the 401k style plan, and I hope you guys vote or would consider continuing on with their program. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next person is Dennis Martin.
Hi, my name is Dennis Martin. I live at 8706 North Osceola. Been in my house for 25 years now. And my one of two thoughts here is again on the pension. There's very strong concern on the pension.
Can you speak a little louder, please?
Sure. So I have a big concern on the pension. I have a very big concern on the pension. I work in the business world, the private business world, and I see how they are pulling back in all areas as far as contributing to the pensions. And by us moving over into, or the board voting to move to this IMF, my big concern is that somebody's going to be reaching into my wallet for a little bit more money to pay for it. You know, it's nice to have pensions, but you know what? The city of Chicago can't afford it. The city of Niles can't afford it. The older people can't afford it. The poorer people can't afford it. And by moving and shifting to that type of a plan, my big concern is that it looks okay now, but what's it gonna look like on down the road? My second point is in regards to, I got a wonderful colored flyer from Niles. I think it was, I don't know who it's mailed out to, but it was beautiful. But my concern is, what's the cost? Again, I work in the business world. I work at Kraft Heinz. They came out with a directive and said, no color, none. I think in today's world, we should find a way to be more green, decrease our footprint, carbon footprint, and again, save money. The cost to print that multi-page colored glossy, I'd like to see the cost of it. Because I think you could save that and reinvest that. Now, I hate to complain. You know, I applaud everybody that's here. A lot of work to hear, come here and meet and discuss things and get everything out. So those are my two big things. And I'll leave it there.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dennis.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Myrna Celeste, and I'm at 8460 North Chester. And I just had a few comments today. The first one was concerning two meetings ago in August, when several of us got up and we discussed our concerns about the change in the bylaw for the pension plan. And many of us got up, many of us were very passionate, and Linda, you told us, I've never heard of this. Where did this come from? I don't know what you're talking about. We're not talking about any pension. A month later, it's in the newspaper. I can't believe it just kind of showed up. So that concerns me a little bit, that all of a sudden it just was there. So that was one thing that like I said, really bothered me with this. Now, regarding that pension plan, my husband, my better half in many ways, was talking about the different types of plans that are available. Again, one of the concerns I have, and I do not know if this is the way it will be, but is this the type of pension plan where somebody works 30 years and then we will continue to pay them for the next 35 or 40 years to go find a second job? I don't know. Nobody will tell me. I've asked several places. And I really can't afford that. I have to tell you, I work my tail off at my job. I'm there sometimes at 6:30 in the morning, I'm working at home, and I really don't want to know that there are people out there taking my money and going and getting a second job after a few years. So no offense to the people that work here, you do great work and I appreciate that, but I also know that we live in, this is the real world now, and we don't have the money. And as much as I would love to have that kind of program, I'd kind of go sometimes, boy, did I blow it 30 years ago. But you know what? It's not right. It's not good. It's not ethical. It's not moral anymore. It really isn't. We are dying here monetarily, whether it's the state, you know, our cities. We can't even pay our own pensions for the police, you know, with the money that's going in. So just a thought on that.
My last thing I would like to say is, well, actually, Linda, I wanted to ask you about the new program that we got the money that was approved from last time. I would like to know why that personnel money was not already in the budget. Did you, you set up a whole program, but there was no budget for people to run it, and you weren't even sure you were going to need them. So we just approved a ton of money. How much was it? 200,000? I don't know. 75,000? Oh, thank you. I'm sorry about that. $75,000 for something you weren't even sure you needed. And that's a huge problem. So I would appreciate, you know, being a little bit more careful with my money and all these people and your own. You're all from Niles. Why would you want to be paying more money? I don't understand. I really don't. Do you not have mortgages and things you have to pay? You need to be responsible to the people. And what I tell people now is when they say, well, the government this, the government that, I look at them and I say, I am the government. You are the government. Okay? It's not the people that run the place. It's us. It's us. And I just want you all to remember that when you're making decisions, that you're making decisions for me and yourselves in this community. And finally, is there any way that maybe, since we're having such trouble with the media quality here, I would ask that maybe could this be something where we have better quality, such as they do at the board meetings, and put it right on public access where everybody could see it? Because then we wouldn't have any issues, any problems. The shut-ins, the homebounds would be able to see it. They wouldn't have to come to the library to do that if they couldn't get out. I think it would be great. So thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Okay, I believe that closes public comment. Thank you everyone who spoke. Treasurer's report.
Okay, refer you to page 34. Okay, it's the end of September, we're one quarter through the year. Our revenue for the month exceeded our budget expectations by $167,000. But we're still a little bit short year to date by about $36,000, and we should catch up over time. Shortfall is primarily due to the way that the county collects and remits real estate taxes. Salaries for the month are $2,241 short of budget estimates, or about 0.8%, and $90,650 short of budget estimates. On the year, that's about 11.4%. Our library materials for the month are $4,100 under budget, or 6.7%, and $28,000 over budget, or 15.6% for the year. And this is due primarily to the payment of annual subscription fees for some of the library's database product offerings, which are slotted earlier in the calendar. As you know, we have to pay a year in advance for those things. And so they create a budget variance early, which we catch up with at the end of the year. Library operating expenses are $2,200 over budget, or about 7.6% for the month, $16,200 under budget, or 18.3% for the year. This is due primarily to slower than anticipated spending in the software and printing lines. G&A, general administrative expenses, is $9,900 in the budget estimates, or 37% for the month, and $20,000 or 25% for the year. And this is due primarily to slow spending in legal and the consultant line items. Just like salaries, employee fringe benefits are about $4,600 in the budget, or about 8.2% for the month, $13,000 or 7.8% for the year. Utilities so far this year is within $2,000 of budgeted expense, both monthly and year to date. And for the month, the net deficit is $258,400, which is $199,000 favorable to the budgeted net deficit of $457,724, and $154,159 favorable, or 13% year to date. If you have any specific questions on any of the financials that are presented along with the report, be happy to answer.
I have one question about the utilities.
You indicated that.
Can you tell me what page that's on?
34.
Thank you.
Sure. It says utilities is within $2,000 of the budget. So what you're saying is we're over 2,000 for the both monthly and year-to-date? Is that what within means? Because I'm showing for year-to-date and just electricity, we're over 4,429.
On page 23?
Yes.
About, I'd say the top half of the page, just above the fold. We're $3,196 under budget for gas for the year. $4,429 over budget for electricity and $346 over budget for water. Those three numbers summed is $1,580, which is over budget for the year, for the quarter.
Okay, thank you. And then my question is again that the electric bill seems to be getting higher and higher. I mean, it used to be $4,000 a month and we thought that was high. Now we're at $10,000. Are we going to reevaluate either the lighting fixtures or have we ascertained why it's getting so much higher since the renovation? We talked about this for about a year now.
Yeah, and we did try to buy power on the open market. And we engaged the consultant who is paid based on the savings that they can realize. And basically said that at this moment, there was no advantage to signing a long-term contract. And our best bet was to pay what Commonwealth Edison's paying us.
Have we determined that the new fixtures are an issue? Because we weren't this high in electricity. And I know we have very decorative lighting now. But, you know, we never really did do anything in terms, I mean, our architects didn't provide us with any information in terms of whether these are cost-saving lights or just actually very trendy.
You know, it's a combination of usage and breaks. Yeah, so we could perform that analysis.
We should do something. It just keeps skyrocketing though. And it's just the electric.
So it might be an initial cost that's expensive for the new bulbs or something? Because I know the efficient bulbs are expensive, but in the long run, it might benefit us.
And we've been way over budget for almost a year now, so I think it's worth looking into. But thank you for that explanation. I appreciate it.
Very good, thank you very much.
Anything else?
Director's report?
Okay, well, Tony, this meeting so far has been incredibly negative. But an awful lot of wonderful stuff has been going on in the libraries for the last several weeks. I just really want to do a shout out for my staff because I think they've done an incredible job of putting together the new spaces. The open weekend was very successful. We have had a lot of appreciation from the members of the public. I included the list of their comments after that weekend. And they, clearly, they just have a great deal of appreciation for the library. And so I'm very, very happy with some of the things that have been going on here. I also wanted to mention and call your attention to the part of my director's report where I talk about, on page 36, I wanted to thank you all for having the managers attend Managers Boot Camp. It was a wonderful experience for everyone and people really got up to speed on the current management law, current HR law, which is very important. Because if you make a mistake with that can be a very expensive mistake over time. I wanted to mention that Cindy and I attended the workshop on strategic planning. And so we have found one possibility of a way to approach strategic planning that we are looking into a little bit further and we will come back to you. But you can look up this person, George Needham, if you want to. I gave you his name in case you wanted to look into him a little bit further. Not that I'm suggesting him as a consultant, but he has a particular approach for strategic planning that I think might work well for us. Let's see, we have a Buildings and Grounds meeting tentatively scheduled for November 5th. That seems to be the date that worked best for the members of that committee.
Can I ask what day of the week that is?
Thursday.
Thursdays are okay. Thank you.
Good. I have one piece of bad news, which is, two pieces of bad news actually, which is that the Wi-Fi hotspots that we have been circulating, the company that we bought them from was bought up by Sprint. Sprint is pulling the plug on them as of November 7th. So, or November 6th, and it's affecting us and some of the schools, and it's a shame. So we are looking at just the other options right now that unfortunately we're not going to be able to proceed with that. The Sprint's offer is much, much more expensive. So we're looking around to see if we can get something that will work better for us.
So do we just have like a contracted time, and then they give us up to the time, and then we're cut off unless we pay a new price?
Month to month, basically, yeah. But starting November 6th, everybody has to be on this other plan that I think is like $38 a piece a month, which is a lot of money.
How many do we have?
It's five.
Oh, okay. So I think that we would loan out just...
Yes, and they've been, no, no, well, one was just patrons.
Patrons.
Some of the schools have a similar kind of deal that was with Clear that has also been...
What are we paying now?
Pardon me?
What are we paying now?
Because we're $10 a month?
$10 per device for unlimited, data.
Thank you.
The Sprint offering is roughly $40, and we add all of the ends to it for the same service per device. So it's roughly increased by a factor of four plus Sprint wants a 2-year contract. You know, so if you read the Chicago Tribune, there's an article addressing this in the paper today that indicates that you know, I don't know all the bodies, but some group of folks are getting together to sue in order to continue with it, the favorable pricing. But I understand the article briefly. It sounds like they're paper.
So that's disappointing.
Can I just ask a question? These are the Wi-Fi that patrons get to check out and they take home and then they have free Wi-Fi.
That's correct.
How many units do we own?
Five.
Okay.
I'm sorry, we actually own six, we circulate five.
Five, okay.
And we keep a spare in the office.
Sure, okay, thank you.
And then the other thing that I wanted you to know is that normally the per capita grant from the state of Illinois, the application is due in October, but they have postponed that deadline to January. And just so you know, a lot of the library directors are very dubious that we will be seeing a per capita grant at all this year from the state. We're figuring that we'll probably hold on to the application, so I don't think that we can count on that money.
So that's usually a good chunk too, isn't it?
You know, the last couple of years it was $71,600. So yes, that was how we paid for all of that technology last year and all the early literacy things the year before. So it has bought us some nice things in the past. So we'll still put in the application, of course, and you know, maybe we'll be completely wrong. It will come through, but I don't think we can count on it. We have never put things in the per capita grant that were vital things. They were always kind of the extra things. So anyway, we will be talking more about what to apply for. And then the last thing I wanted to mention is that we do have our new supervisor on board today. I'd like to introduce you to Susie Wolf.
Hi.
She is off to a great start managing the technology floor downstairs. And so we're already off to a great start with that. Welcome to Susie.
Welcome.
And that is all I have. There's just so much on the agenda. I didn't want to load you up.
Okay, any communications? Committee reports, building and grounds will be next month. Do we have a time on your building and grounds meeting? And
yeah.
Your thing is set. Okay, so it'll just be further. Okay. Whenever everyone can make it.
Okay. I'm guessing it would be 7. Yeah. Oh, you know what? I misspoke. There was actually a very nice letter from John D'Amico in the work packet where he thanked, he actually sent it to Sasha's house, his wife, who would have to be there. But he said, well, while reading the bugle, I think the greatest audios of the Niles Public Library is now offering, and I wanted to thank you and everyone else at the library for all the hard work you have put into acquiring such a vast array of cutting edge technology. Having access to such advanced and exciting technology is a great opportunity for everyone in our community. So I was very happy to get that.
Liaison reports? Friends of the Library.
That meeting was canceled or something at the last moment.
Anything legislative? Rails?
Nope. Everybody's off it. We have a library association conference right now.
And secretary's report? Barb? Is there anything else, secretary? Okay.
Looking for something who's not there.
All right. It's okay. New business, adopt ordinance 1506. Okay. Entertain a motion to adopt ordinance 15-06, an ordinance determining personal property no longer necessary or useful to the Niles Public Library District and authorizing its convenience or sale.
Second.
Any discussion?
Will you check sell it or do you think we're going to have to sell it?
Yeah, I think, well, first of all, these are the pieces of equipment that were replaced by the new printer, copier, scanners that the library bought last month. These pieces of equipment are 8 or 9 years old, so we've pretty much run all of the useful life out of them. We are going to try to sell them. We'll try to put them on rails to see if we get anybody to bite, but most likely we'll have to dispose of them in a gray manner with you know, somebody that handles that, you know, type of stuff and to give us the right certification. So, but there's a list of printers and copiers, I think it's page 57. Mm-hmm. You know, by serial number. You know, I don't know that there's much value. So.
Any other discussion? Can we take a roll? Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Karen?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, I'd like to read a short intro before I entertain a motion for the item B. The Niles Public Library District is embarking on a study of the library's retirement offerings to its full-time employees. For the next several months, there will be a recurring agenda item for the regular monthly meetings of the Board of Trustees. Library Retirement Plan Investigation is what it's going to be called. Under this agenda item, the board plans to review retirement plan options, including the current plan offering and the pension plan offering by Illinois Municipal Retirement Fund, IMRF, among other alternatives which board members and staff may bring to the attention of the board. The board's intention is to elevate the library's retirement plan offering so it is no longer one of the bottom tier plans in the area and to aid the library in its mission to provide over-the-top service to the residents of the Niles Public Library District and its patrons by retaining expert librarians and staff at the district. The board expects that it will vote on a retirement plan offering sometime after the end of the calendar year and will implement the new retirement plan offering on July 1st, 2016, which is the beginning of the new fiscal year. For the month of October, we will begin the study by reviewing this current retirement plan offering of the library with George Antazis of ICMA. So I would like to entertain a motion to, it's just discussion notes. So,
would you like to take these? Work hard. And I focus on anywhere between 20 to 25 municipalities, and by far this is the most organized and diligent folks of individuals that I work with. Okay, I just want to get that out in the clear. I am part of ICMARC. I am not part of IMRF, which is the defined.
I'm sorry.
I'll get into that, sir. Just give me a few minutes, okay? ICMARC is different than IMRF. IMRF is what the defined benefit, the pension program that the residents have opinions on. I am not part of that organization, nor am I going to express what I think about it. I'll just give you my opinions or give you some ideas, walk you through what the employees currently have, and answer any questions, okay? So we'll get into a little bit about myself, what I do for the employees, how I help them. Talk about the 457 plan, which one gentleman said was a 401k. The 457 is the public sector version of a 401k. And I want to make sure everyone understands how it works, how it helps employees. Go into some of the participation, that's important. Most of you want to know, from an employee perspective, are people participating? Are employees taking advantage of the 7.5% that's going in? And talk about what I do and how I help employees looking ahead. Is that all right? Do I have 15 minutes? Is that okay?
Yep. Yes.
All right. Yes. So, again, my name is George Fantasis. I'm with ICMARC, International City Managers Association Retirement Corporation. Everyone say that 5 times. Right? Our firm is based out of Washington, D.C. I live in Arlington Heights. I'm an Arlington Heights resident. And my role is to educate. It is to sit down with employees like Sasha and Susie and Greg and Susan and talk about retirement planning. Okay? We discuss mutual funds. We talk about Roth IRAs, pre-tax earnings, stock markets, financial planning topics. That is my role, is to sit with folks on site while they're working or after hours to talk about these plans. Okay? We, ICMARC, we are a not-for-profit organization. Okay, I am not a commissioned salesperson. I'm a salaried employee, and my job is to educate, is to get folks enrolled so they understand the importance of why it makes sense to put money away for retirement. Okay? The other things we talk about are other financial planning. We look at things like long-term care insurance needs. We look at estate planning needs. So my job is, again, focusing on retirement, but also looking at other facets of a good financial plan. Okay? I'll stop there. Does anyone have questions about ICMARC, my role? Makes sense for everybody? Okay. Now, the 457 plan is what the core product that most folks like Sasha and other folks have with us. Okay? The 457 plan is the 401k version for public sector employees. Okay? So for example, Village of Niles employees who I work with have a 457 plan. Niles Park District employees have a 457 plan. The City of Evanston employees. All municipal employees have a 457 plan. And what that is a savings vehicle. Employees voluntarily put money out of their paycheck, voluntarily, on a pre-tax basis. That money gets invested and is there for their retirement. Okay, so when they retire at 63, 64, whatever that is, they have retirement savings, they have Social Security, possibly pension income, and they use that to live and supplement the retirement. Okay? The biggest difference between the 457 plan and the 401k is the access to your money. Who here has a 401k or an IRA?
I have one.
Okay. Okay. Can you tell me when you can access that money penalty free?
59.
That's correct. So with a 401k or a 403b, which teachers have, you can access your money when you turn 59 and a half. Without a penalty, but you pay what?
You have to pay taxes.
Pay taxes, exactly. The 457 is different. You access that money as soon as you separate from the library. That's any age. See the difference?
But you still pay taxes.
You still pay taxes, but you do not pay that penalty. You only pay, like I said, the income taxes because the money went in on a pre-tax basis. You have a choice of 28 mutual funds. My job is to educate you on that funds if you don't have an idea as to how these funds help you. We talk about risk, we talk about your age, we talk about your goals, we talk about anything that you don't understand to make sure we put you in the right funds. Okay? This is a voluntary plan for employees. This is not mandatory. Employees decide on their own, A, how much they can afford, and B, where they want to invest their funds. Okay? Questions on the 457 plan? All right. Now, the unique relationship I have with the employees here is that the Niles Public Library is contributing, as a voluntary contribution, up to 7.5% per year. Correct? That is not like any other organization that I work with. I cover about 25 municipalities. This is the only organization that contributes on the client's behalf. Okay? However, what don't employees have that other municipalities do have? What is it? It's IMRF, correct. That is the big difference. So if I go to the Village of Niles, the Niles Park District, Village, City of Park Ridge, employees don't have a choice but to participate in IMRF, and the city is contributing on their behalf, right? But they also do a 457 plan where the employees put money on their own. It's voluntary to supplement and bridge that gap. Make sense? So we have some employees here that take advantage or capitalize on the idea of, hey, this is money that is being put on my behalf for my retirement that I need. Or the other option is take the money in cash in the form of a salary. Right, Greg?
Right.
Okay. Yes, sir. Question.
You know, I work out in the business world.
Okay.
You know what? 7%'s gone down, 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 down. Where are you getting the money to pay for that 7% that you're contributing? It's got to come from some budget somewhere.
Plus, you're going to give them a regular pension plan, too. Where are we going to get this money?
Sir, first off, I'm not paying
anybody.
I'm
sorry,
anybody.
I'm just putting the questions to the end.
You're telling me that some people have two plans, 401k, and they're contributing to that, or the entity like the board here or the library is contributing to that.
Excuse me, but there's no public comment right now, so can we please talk later? Thank you. Go ahead.
Okay. So I can answer your questions off site if you want, or after the board.
No,
thank you.
Okay. So, the 457 plan, does anyone have questions on the flexibility, the importance? It's a retirement savings goal.
Excuse me, you said that when an employee separates from the library, they take that money with them and then they have to be taxed on them?
Correct, on the withdrawals.
Are they able to roll it over? If they go elsewhere, can they roll it over into another retirement fund?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Without being taxed?
Without any penalties, because it's going from one retirement entity to the next, tax-free money. Okay? Mm-hmm. This plan gives employees a lot of flexibility. It is the only product that is out there on the retirement side that allows employees or participants to take money out under the age of 59 and a half. So for example, Sasha, I hope you don't mind me using an example. Sasha, in 10 years, when he's, let's say, 40 years old, says, you know what, I found a better opportunity at the Village of Niles, or I'm sorry, at the Arlington Heights Library. The money that he saved within the Niles Boyd Library is accessible because he's separated. Other plans, you have to wait until you're 59 and a half, okay? And as I said, some employees are capitalizing on this. They like the idea of employees getting contributed funds on their behalf. Others don't. They take it in the form of savings and, paycheck, payroll. Correct. Okay?
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Just for clarification,
yes.
The library only
right.
has the 457K.
457, that's all it is.
The 457.
It's not a 401k.
And the library
yes.
pays 7.5% into all the employees.
Voluntarily, correct. So if the employee wants to put money in, they can. If they want to take a portion of it and put it into the plan, and the other portion and put it into salary, they have that capability as well.
So then my question is, we put in 7.5%, are the employees expected to put an additional amount in on their own? Or it's just strictly the library funding it?
The employees have the discretion to put whatever they want in the plan, up to obviously limits based on IRS.
So it's not 7.5 from us and they have to put in 4, like there's no
correct.
Equation.
That's correct.
Right, then my other question is, I'm just trying to figure out what's actually the driver to have a pension today at 7.5%? Why would we need a percentage of 7.5% when across the country, I mean, 4.5 if you're lucky, 3%. Why are we at 7.5? What was our point?
Again, I'm not here to answer those questions.
Yeah.
That's up to Greg and.
So it's just a number we just picked out? Is that what you're saying? There's no purpose behind it? It's just a number that we.
I'm not exactly sure. Yeah,
oh,
based,
sorry.
We just,
no problem.
We're just the platform.
Right. I see.
The employees and the board and
this was
the folks here.
It was
elected
so
to.
We, use that number
7.5%
okay.
right. For employees.
I believe it was a substitute. Instead of employees not having access to an IMRF pension, mm-hmm. like most do in the public sector, they're going to say we're going to give you 7.5% in the form of a retirement plan, a 457, and you can manage it on your own.
Right.
Is that right or wrong? That's up to you to decide here today. But I will tell you that. This is the only organization that doesn't provide the pension system. Is it, again, it's up to you to say if it's right or wrong, if it's right for the employees or not. I'm not here to judge that.
Sir,
yes, ma'am.
Maybe we can hire an actuary to give us a good number.
As to?
What would be a good percentage?
I think Greg was working on that with
That's even better. Okay, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
Do you know what percentage Arlington Heights contributes to the employees?
for the employees?
I don't have that information typically. And remember, a pension, a defined benefit through IMRF works twofold. You have a mandatory contribution by the employee, and you get a mandatory contribution from the entity, the municipality, the library, the park district, which in some cases will be equal or more, depending on the plan and the agreement you set aside through IMRF. So for example, if Sasha worked for Arlington Heights Park District and he was part of IMRF, he would have to put in 4.5% out of his salary into this pension, and the park district may put another 5%, 6%, 7%. That's just how it is. Now that won't allow another 457 plan separately and have additional employer contributions. That's all gonna be Sasha's money voluntarily. But people do it. Make sense?
Well, I just wanna make one comment. I know you mentioned that a lot of other municipalities have the IMRF.
Correct.
But truth be told, all these other municipalities are coming up with very creative ways to try to survive IMRF because they cannot afford it. So they're cutting hours, employees don't even work full time.
That's correct.
So it's not a lucrative suggestion at all, and it's really strapping a lot of
these taxing bodies.
Well, no, it's out of the ballpark to consider when you think of its cost.
Of course.
So I know everybody has it, you keep repeating that, but it has devastated a lot of districts. Just wanted to make sure we're aware of that.
All right, if I could ask, now, the employees can put in their own discretion. So
that's
they could put in a dollar, they could put in
percentage. Correct, okay. Yes.
All right.
Excuse me, Danette, are you talking about the the one we have?
Yes.
Okay, because we keep going back and forth.
No, okay. I would have said
they sound alike, so, right?
Okay, yeah. No, I'm talking here.
ICMARC,
yes,
correct.
Yes,
okay,
yes.
Right.
Okay. But the library, so really it would be beneficial for an employee, technically, I guess, if I'm understanding, because the library's providing 7.5% on their annual salary, not what they contribute.
That's correct.
Okay.
Correct.
Bonus.
So that would be...
Bonus. Sign me up. Hire me.
I mean, this has confused me for... and I had another question that I wanted to... Oh, all right, so when it comes to now, when you mentioned taxes,
correct.
Okay?
Yes.
The employees now that take it as income.
Correct, get taxed.
When we, right, okay, so is that, how am I wording this, or maybe this might pursue. All right, let's just take it out of the air. Let's say I work for the library, my salary was $60,000, and I'll notate Danette makes $60,000 a year.
Okay.
But if I'm taking that 7 in my hand as income, does it show that I'm really making additional, or does...
No, that's income. That's
so
taxable
it's considered
income.
Your actual income.
Absolutely.
Income.
So you have a choice. You can either get taxed on that 7.5% as income, or put it away pre-tax in a retirement plan, have it grow tax deferred, and pay the taxes later.
Okay.
Or you can do a combination, depending on your circumstances and what you want to do. My role is to educate the employees about the importance of putting money away,
right.
Especially when it's a lucrative 7.5%.
Right, no, absolutely.
That's my job, is to educate and sit down and talk about the importance. And some employees, again, they can afford it, some can't, depending on the circumstances. Okay?
I'll come to the question.
Yes?
I think you said that most yearly plans have both IMRF and
457.
Plan.
Right.
Do any of the other clients put money into their employees 457 if they also have an IMRF? Or
usually not.
Most of them,
it's one or the other. Correct.
Okay. All right.
Some do. Most of them do not. It's one or the other. Because again, a municipality is putting sometimes 8 to 10% in IMRF on the client's behalf.
That's fine. I just want
on the employee's behalf. Yeah, but usually it's not both. The 457 is their own voluntary contributions. Some people start out with $50, they make increases over time, and it's there to supplement the pension.
Okay.
Yeah. So what you just said, the 457 is basically the supplemental pension, and that's really all we have. We don't have a pension, we just have a supplemental pension.
That's correct.
Basically.
Well,
that's correct. And if, I mean, are you taking Social Security into account or no?
Well, Well, pension, yeah, that would be a pension plan.
Correct.
If there is still social security, yes.
Yeah, go ahead.
Go ahead.
Well, I was in private industry, okay?
Right.
They gave us the option of taking 401K.
Right.
We put so much money of our paycheck, 5, 6, 7%, up to a certain limit.
Right.
They would add to that also.
That's correct.
That was my pension. That was being built up for my pension.
I understand that, right. That's your own pension that you're creating for yourself.
Right, I'm creating this for myself.
That's correct.
I didn't expect somebody else to put some more money into my pocket so I could have a better pension. I had to work with what I had, and then I had to, when I retired, I had to reinvest that money so that it would be beneficial for me. But it was my money. In some cases.
It was your money as well as the company's money, because they were putting money on your bed.
Exactly.
There was a match, correct? So there was a mix there, right?
My money, but they gave it to me.
That's correct.
Okay, but in the other cases where you have that pension, as the other gentleman stated.
Right.
You could lose that. It depends on if the municipality goes under. They can't stress it. You see what's happening in Illinois right now. Chicago, Cook County.
I'm going to share an opinion as to, do I think the city, the board should approve this or not for the employees? It's not, you know, it's not my place to do that. What I'm telling you is based on my experiences with different municipalities, other libraries and park districts and so forth. That's all I'm saying.
Okay.
And this is the only organization that doesn't have it. It could be a good thing. Most of you probably agree with it, but some may view it differently.
Well, we're looking at it as a taxpayer's endpoint, okay?
I understand that.
Well, can we afford it or can't we afford it?
Correct.
Okay.
Thank you. Can I ask one question?
Sure, of course.
Companies or organizations that have both. Some have the IMRF and the 457.
That's correct.
But the one employee can't participate in both.
Absolutely. And the 457 is voluntary.
Okay.
It's their own money going in.
So they can.
The city or the municipality or the district is not putting money in 457 as well as the pension. It's one or the other.
But we're putting money into a 457.
Correct.
Yeah. Oh, but because you have one doesn't mean you have to put money into it? The employer does not have to.
The employer has the employee has the choice of either taking it as a salary or putting it away towards retirement.
But the employer does not have to contribute to 457, you're saying? In companies that have both?
Wait, no, of course not.
No.
Okay, so we can choose, or a company can choose to contribute or not, but an employee can be in both.
Absolutely.
IMRF and this.
I would say 85% of the people that I work with, so for example, the Village of Deerfield, right? You have 80% participation in the 457 plan.
Mm-hmm.
And again, they have both IMRF as well as ICMA's 457. There's both. See what I mean? Employees recognize the importance of putting money away to supplement their IMRF and their Social Security. So they're putting away $100 or $200, whatever they can afford based on their budget.
Well, I thought IMRF was, there are some tiers involved, so I thought maybe 457 in some of these cases is what they were going to get away from IMRF, so it cost them less.
No,
okay, but it's not. They can go into both. Okay.
Absolutely. Yeah, the employees can go into both. 457 is voluntary because it's their own money going in.
Okay.
And it's another way for them to save pre-tax money, have it invested, and be there to take out upon retirement.
Can I ask, are you going to share the details on the IMR? Because from what I heard from the 457, I have some questions about...
I'm not an IMR representative.
Okay, so they're going to understand this is
ICMARC. They sound alike, right?
No, I am.
But I am not IMRF. I'm not a representative.
Okay.
There's other folks like myself that visit Susan and Greg and board and talk about the benefits, costs, and so forth.
Greg and I wanted the board and the public to know what our current plan was. So
Right.
That's why we invited George, so that everybody would have a chance to know what we're currently doing. Then in future months, we will be inviting people from IMRF and from any place else if anybody else has something else to suggest, we'll invite them too. We just wanted the board to have the maximum amount of information that they could have to make a good decision. And we really appreciate George.
No
Thank you so much.
I have a few more things if you're interested.
Sure.
Is that okay?
Sure.
So just to have an idea as to where we stand, the total asset level in this fund, yes, sir.
Thank you.
Wait, I'm sorry. No.
Everybody else had a shot?
No, we're continuing.
Thank you very
much. Presenter, you're welcome.
I hope that's on the record also.
Okay, so total balance of the plan currently is $2.8 million in assets. That's divided between about 50 employees, 28 active, which are putting money away. Some of them might be former employees that have left that still have that money in the plan, okay? And that money is invested in different buckets. It could be high-risk funds, low-risk fund, medium-risk funds, and so forth. And again, my role is to sit down and to educate and give the employees more knowledge as to how these plans help them, what their options are for withdrawals, and talk about their other facets of their financial plan. Going forward, Greg and I, myself, and Kathy and Susan talk about, well, how else can we improve participation? How can we get folks more educated? They've done a fantastic job, again, because they're first class, of giving me access. I mean, I'm not here every day for 35 minutes with every employee, taking away time from their busy schedules, but I think 2 to 3 times a year to sit down, either as a group like today, individually to get them enrolled, is almost a requirement, right? Mm-hmm. So they provide me 2 to 3 times a day to come visit with the employees face-to-face, talk about their plans, and give them some suggestions. I'm also going to hopefully participate in a group session. I think it's in January or February, where all the employees meet. Again, we talk about the importance of their options and putting this money away, doing lunch and learns and so forth, sponsored by us, making sure folks are aware of their planning options. So again, if you have questions, feel free to filter them through the board, and thank you for the time.
And just have one other kid. Was that 28 employees you said?
28 active employees.
28 active employees.
Again, but remember, folks, not everybody is eligible for that 7.5%. So maybe Susan and Greg can highlight who is actually eligible. Part-timers, you know, some full-time, maybe that would be an important facet to go over as well. Because, again, that's...
The only other thing that we're going to need to know, Susan, is how many employees actually get the 7.5% benefit.
Greg has all that.
So, and compared to the 28 employees.
I'm just going to try.
I will give you 30 seconds because it's already...
I just have a question.
Go ahead.
Not a debate, just a question.
Yes, sir.
On that 7.5% in the curve plan,
yeah.
How easy is that to go downward 1%? Would that go to the Illinois Supreme Court?
I don't make those decisions as to your contribution rates on the plan.
I mean, the plan would change. Is it changeable in a quick and easy manner? That's, I guess, my question.
I don't have an answer for that. So you'd have to direct that through the board and the members of the library. Again, I don't review the details that they have to put in. This is a voluntary contribution that the library is trying to incentivize and promote retirement planning for employees. And since they don't have a defined benefit, like an IMRF, they're substituting it with this 7.5%.
Thank you.
That's all it is.
Thank you.
So, thanks so much.
Just one more.
Yeah.
I mean, just for myself to understand, because when you do have a 457 or any type of pension,
right,
you're contributing your money for retirement and investing it in pension in hopes when you retire, they're going to be able to survive.
Right.
And plan correctly.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So if the library is providing 7.5, and I apologize if you answer this already.
It's okay.
How is that really legal when they're investing in 457? How is it legal not to invest that money and just give it to them as income? You understand what I'm saying? I mean, I've never heard of like a 401 or 457 or where, I mean, now I have a 401 and my company will match 4%.
Right, right.
They don't give me the option, well, I'll give you the forms and cover me on invest.
That agreement was set aside years ago, separately. Again, and it's the only unique scenario that I have within the plans that I service. You know, take it as, is it wrong, is it bad? But again, that's just what it is. And as I said, some people capitalize on it. They like the idea of taking that money in the form of a salary or putting it money away towards retirement or splitting or whatever it is.
Are the employees vested right away?
Yes. This is their own money?
1 year. Takes 1 year before you start getting that.
Go ahead. I don't know if you can answer this, or I should ask my own staff. How many employees invest the 7.5%? How many employees go beyond the 7.5% and put in their own money?
I can't give you the specifics. I can tell you that total active, which includes the 7.5, is about 28. Do we know roughly how many are eligible?
44.
So 20 out of 44
are participating in law, or are taking the 7.5% and putting it in deferred cash, is that right? 28, only 28 out of 44.
Yeah.
And of course, 44 are just the only employees who are eligible. There are lots of employees who are not eligible.
That's correct.
That's correct.
It's eligible for full time.
Okay. And do a number of those 28 people go beyond the 7.5?
Some do.
Some of their own money
again,
too?
Some do, some don't. I don't have the specifics.
Okay.
And remember, too, we have other vehicles. We have Roth IRAs, payroll Roth IRAs, that have benefits to the employees, tax-free money, accessibility. So some may use 7.5 and 457 and take another $50 or $100 and put it towards a Roth IRA. Again, every scenario is different.
Okay, and of course, the Roth IRA, that would be entirely their own money.
Oh, all 100%
their own money.
The 100% is their own money, correct.
And I presume that your 457 plan affords all kinds of investment options.
28 funds within the plan. Correct.
Okay, stock, bonds, whatever,
stocks, bonds,
combination,
safe.
Whatever.
Absolutely.
People want to choose.
Correct.
Okay.
Can they get a do they have a guaranteed minimum rate of return, or can they lose money in this program, or is it, what are you guys?
We have a combination of both. So for someone that's closer to retirement that wants to be safe, doesn't want to see their principal and earnings fluctuate, they'll put it in something more of a money market or a short-term bond fund. We have something called the plus fund that's earning about 1.5%. You have to remember the difference between a 457 and a 401k versus a pension is what? A pension is lifetime income. You can be 95 years old and collect a lifetime income stream, right? And it's a paycheck.
60 and you got 30 years to go.
A 457 is a savings plan that allows you to take money out as you need it. So there's differences there, and I think it's important that everyone recognizes how
it is. It's a big difference with what we're against is this lifetime. Trying to give someone a lifetime guaranteed stream of income on the taxpayer's back.
Okay, thank you.
Like I said, other municipalities are doing so. Sure, thank you so much.
Thank you
thank
for
you
your
very much. Sure, appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you for your information.
Okay, discuss the tax levy of the Mass Public Library for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2015 and ending until June 30th, 2016.
So here's a brief presentation on the levy. First, some background information. The 2014 property tax levy. This is the money that's collected during the calendar year 2015. So the first installment, which is usually due in the February timeframe, comes in the first half of the fiscal year, and then comes in the last half of the fiscal year, and then the second installment, which usually arrives in the August timeframe, comes in the first half of the new fiscal year. The collections are net of reductions and refunds, which are paid to property owners based on protests that they file with the county as to that equalized assessed valuation on their property. The final 2014 property tax levy was just under $6 million. The aggregate is actually a little bit higher, and the way that the county arrives at the aggregate extension is they take the actual levy, the request that's sent in by the library and other taxing districts, and they add 3% to that to account for lost revenue and things of that nature due to refunds and reductions. We budget at $5,918,000 as opposed to the $6.1 million because we never expect to collect the difference. We expect, and based on experience, we see that we collect closer to the actual levy that we filed. Okay? The 2015-2016 fiscal year budget was constructed using the final 2014 property tax levy for the entire year. Because we didn't have a levy, in place for the last half of the fiscal year, it would look kind of odd if we only had a half year worth of revenue. So, to show what it would look like, we typically take the previous year's levy and assume in the budget that it's going to persist at the same level. It's done for analysis only, and of course, ultimately the board's decision on what the levy will look like. Some of the considerations for the 2015 levy. Our expenditures grow at 2.7% per year. That's called a compounded annual growth rate. And that's the rate at which every year you increase your expenditures by 2.7% in order to replicate the curve that that our last five budget years represents. Special revenue funds, we're running out of money. And that was done on purpose. We had somewhere over $1 million, maybe 1.1 or 1.4 million a couple of years ago, and we purposefully drove down the levies for those special revenue funds so that we could spend those fund balances down and make better use of those monies. Remember, once money goes into a special revenue fund, it can only come out for that specific purpose. So for auditing, for example, if we have money in the auditing fund, we can only spend it on auditing our books and records. Another consideration is the new TIF district that's been created by the village. The new TIF district encompasses about $80 million of equalized assessed value. Our entire district has about $1.4 billion in equalized assessed value. So the TIF district includes 5.7% of the library district property. This is important because if the value of the TIF property increases, any additional
calendar year 2015. So the first installment, which is usually due in the February time frame, comes in the first half of the fiscal year, and then this comes in the last half of the fiscal year, and then the second installment, which usually arrives in the August time frame, comes in the first half of the new fiscal year. The collections are net of reductions and refunds, which are paid to property owners based on protests that they file with the county as to the equalized assessed valuation on their property. The final 2014 property tax levy was just under $6 million. The aggregate extension is actually a little bit higher, and the way that the county arrives at the aggregate extension is they take the actual levy, the request that's sent in by the library and other taxing districts, and they add 3% to that to account for lost revenue and things of that nature due to refunds and reductions. We budget at $5,918,000 as opposed to the $6.1 million because we never expect to collect the difference. We expect, and based on experience, we see that we collect closer to the actual levy that we filed. Okay? The 2015-2016 fiscal year budget was constructed using the final 2014 property tax levy for the entire year. Because we didn't have a levy, in place for the last half of the fiscal year, it would look kind of odd if we only had a half year worth of revenue. So, to, you know, to show what it would look like. We typically take the previous year's levy and assume in the budget that it's going to persist at the same level. It's done for analysis only, and of course, you know, ultimately the board's decision on the levy will look like. Some of the considerations for the 2015 levy. Our expenditures grow at 2.7% per year. That's called the compounded annual growth rate. And that's the rate at which every year you increase your expenditures by 2.7% in order to replicate the curve that that our last five budget years represents. Special revenue funds, we're running out of money. And that was done on purpose. We had somewhere over $1 million, maybe 1.1 or 1.4 million a couple of years ago, and we purposefully drove down the levies for those special revenue funds so that we could spend those fund balances down and make better use of those monies. Remember, once money goes into a special revenue fund, it can only come out for that specific purpose. So for auditing, for example, if we have money in the auditing fund, we can only spend it on auditing our books and records. Another consideration is the new TIF district that's been created by the village. The new TIF district encompasses about $80 million of equalized assessed value. Our entire district has about $1.4 billion in equalized assessed value. So the TIF district includes 5.7% of the library district property. This is important because if the value of the TIF property increases, any additional taxes associated with the increase of that value gets raked off and into the TIF district and we never see it. Okay. Another consideration is growth and expansion in current services. We've seen most recently the digital services department get up and running. We don't know what that's going to look like in the future, how popular it's going to be. And we also have strategic planning on the agenda for the year, so we don't know what the outputs from strategic planning are going to be. In terms of the general fund is the fund that pays the ongoing operating expenses of the library. So for this analysis, we froze revenue in the general fund and basically said, for purposes of discussion, that we will not see any increases in revenue. The expenditures, of course, we grew by the compounded annual growth rate, and that's 2.7%. So here's some numbers. The 2015-2016 column, that's the budget that we're currently operating under, and you can see that it yields a surplus at the end of the current fiscal year of close to $600,000. And then as the expenses grow, 2.7% compounded annually, freezing the general fund revenues, you can see that the surplus deficit declines each year until 2019-2020, when it turns into an actual deficit. The special revenue funds, as I said earlier, all funds except for the liability insurance fund will run out of money in the 2016-2017 cycle. Liability insurance runs out of money in 21-22. For some reason, it predates me that there was a significant amount of money built up in that fund. Therefore, the reason I mention this is in some of the analysis we added back and we exclude it because it's not a fund that needs any money. We just continue to spend that fund balance down. So the total annual fund deficit in 2016-2017 is expected to be $182,701. Based on expenditure increases and keeping the tax rate the same. And by 2021, it grows to $329,000. As a side note, there's $113,000 of fund balance that remains at the start of 2018. Actually, that should be 2016, 2017, I'm sorry for the typo. And that's why it starts at $182,000 instead of something close to $300,000. This is what the annual fund deficit looks like, growing on a fund-by-fund basis. You can see that we have six special revenue funds, audit, liability insurance, Social Security, workers' comp, unemployment's comp, and building and site. In 2015-16, the total annual fund deficit is $315,000, but if we add back the liability insurance fund balance, we get something closer to $288,000. And then you can see how it progresses out through the 2021 period. As I said earlier, the Village of Niles has created a new TIF. There are the numbers that I went over earlier. So the question, the $64,000 question is always, what's that mean to us? Okay, there's a couple of ways that we could look at it. If all property values individually increased at the same rate, including the property values of the property in the TIF district, we shouldn't see any loss in revenue, because there won't be any additional revenues collected by the TIF district on the library levy. Okay? But another way to look at it is, what if all of, let's freeze all of the values, equalized assessed valuations of the property outside the TIF district, and then grow the TIF district to the maximum. We hope it'll be worth this much, $180 or $170 million. If in that case, there will be an additional $367,000 of library tax levy that will be billed to the TIF district, and therefore we'll never see, because the TIF district will actually get it. We use that money to pay for improvements within that particular district. That's an extreme, okay? God only knows, well, maybe the mayor, how fast the projects are gonna take off, what value increases the projects will yield, and what it'll mean in terms of that district. Go ahead.
So this amount we're talking about, like $367,000, that's over what period of time? Are we saying
that's an annual number, and okay. And the big assumption there is, as I said, every property value outside of the district stays flat.
Mm-hmm.
So your house doesn't see an increase in the equalized assessed valuation. And all of the property within the district increases from $80 million to $170 million, which is their target. Okay. Over time, the TIF has a 23-year life. It would be unfair to take that 367 and multiply it by 23 years and say, oh my God, this is what we're going to lose. Because that would be, that's just not realistic. I mean, what's more realistic is that we will see property values throughout the library district creep, get bigger. Will they get bigger at the same rate or at a lesser rate as the TIF district property values do? I don't know.
Okay.
Okay. Also, this 367 assumes everything is built out, everything is up and running, everything has an equalized assessed value within the district. So it's not a tomorrow number, but it's down the road. We're going to see, we're going to see money not coming to us, but going to the TIF district.
Okay.
Okay. Let's see. Potential for growth and expansion in current services. So we've seen the newly open spaces, the Creative Studio and the Wonderground. We generate comments regarding the growth of the spaces. One real easy comment I picked up was, the kids' space should consider taking over the space just outside of the Wonder Ground at some point to expand those services, because architecturally, it looks like it's an easy thing to do. It already kind of looks like it's blocked off. But all of it, you know, takes money, it takes staff, you know, it takes resources. And it's difficult to predict how the new spaces are going to be accepted and how the usage will take off. One thing we could point to is that Smashbox Weekend was a great success, as well as a recent promotion to get your photograph taken in front of our green screen and put, basically put virtually on Clark and Addison in front of Wrigley Field. So, you know, our successes or lack of success, may generate more or less demand for services and even further growth opportunities. Strategic plans, that's on the agenda for this year. Previous strategic plan called for a service point in the northwestern area of the district. We always talk about the Niles Public Library District as the Niles Library, but only half the residents of the district reside in Niles. The other half reside in unincorporated, I think it's Glenview and Des Plaines primarily. We've been looking for ways to try to engage them more and get them into the library. Depending on the approach, you know, on the low side, it could be a vending type machine that dispenses some sort of Blu-ray or DVD media that, you know, for movies or maybe books or something placed strategically, or it could be as big as a branch with additional furniture collection and IT and staff and programming, et cetera, et cetera. Additionally, we're getting ready to embark on a new cycle, and it's difficult to predict what the outcomes of that exercise will yield. So it's an unknown. So, you know, in summary, the considerations, you know, we have a general fund surplus currently of approximately $600,000 that will turn to a deficit in 5 years. Special revenue funds will need additional funding of over $300,000 annually. If that number is combined with the general fund, the combination will result in a deficit in 2 years. The TIF will reduce tax revenue by some amount when improvements start, but we don't know what that rate will be or how much it will be. And strategic planning and service expansion will likely result in higher costs. Current finances. We have the following fund balances as of the end of the most recent fiscal year. We have in the general fund $6.2 million. But I want to stress that $1.6 million is in the current tax collection account. So the way that, if you remember, the way that our operations work is that we get two big influxes of cash a year. Okay, installment one, installment two. They go into a special tax account, and then we draw from that account as we do payroll and as we pay for electricity and books and everything like that. The special reserve fund is funded at $1.8 million. And if you remember, last fall we passed, the board accepted a justification of about $1.9 million of expenses looking out 10 years or so that included roofs for the building. And the reason I say roofs plural is because it's, you know, we have a number of different roofs, different ages and so forth. Some replacement of HVAC, which will age out. New generator, new van eventually for outreach and delivery services, new equipment for desktop computers and network things, restructuring the parking lot, including the lighting around the building and security cameras, and I can go on to that, but we'll be talking more about that at the meeting. Special revenue account, has $700,000 at the end of the last fiscal year. So remember I said that liability insurance, has a very healthy fund balance? That's close to $300,000, and it could only be spent on liability insurance. So everything else in there, that's, that covers audit fees, that covers workers' compensation, social security, I can't remember what the other two or three accounts are. Overall, how much should the library have in reserve? Our auditors have persisted in saying that they think that about 100% of the budget is appropriate. Sometimes, places will have 75. If you just look at, the 6.2 million, that's more, a little more than 100% of the annual budget. But if you look at the 4.6 million compared to our budget of roughly 5.4 million in the general fund, that's closer to 75%.
And just for clarification, the 1.6 isn't here, but it's coming in.
The 1.6 is in an account that we own, mm-hmm. that's promised for day-to-day operations.
Okay, and we get that. We just can't count on that when we get it. Is that
well, I don't look at it as a reserve because, it's already promised for the payroll in December, the payroll in November, and the light bill in January and stuff. I mean, that's what we have to live on until February.
So the 1.6 million is part of our already 5-point-something budget for the year, is that what you're saying?
No, the 1.6 million is an account with $1.6 million of money in that account.
In addition to what we have in our budget, which is to cover those expenses.
You're mixing assets and you're mixing assets with expenditures. The budget is our expenditures. $5.4 million spent ratably over 12 months.
Okay.
The 1.6 million will pay part of that budget.
Okay.
Okay. As we draw down and incur those expenses.
And how long do we, if we had a 100%, if we had 100% of our annual budget, which is recommended by our auditors, how long will that support us?
Yeah.
What's one to have 100% of our budget in addition to what we have on hand?
So a few years ago, some of the politicians were playing fast and loose with the tax collections and ended up delaying, I believe it was the second installment.
Right.
And till well beyond the elections, okay? So instead of getting a big influx of money in August, they got it in November or December sometime,
okay?
When the final bills were put up. Many, many institutions like us, small governmental institutions, had to go out and borrow money in the form of tax anticipation warrants.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not difficult to do. There's a little bit of a transaction cost, but you have to pay the interest. Libraries that had a healthy fund balance or a reserve didn't have to incur those expenses.
How long ago did you spend?
I can't remember.
Yeah, I remember.
Oh, it's been some time.
Back because when the county collector doesn't collect the money in time, you look at your tax bill in time, sometimes it's delayed, and we don't get the money until even later. And I know some tax bodies did have to go out with the tax anticipation warrants. It's costly to do that.
But we have $8.2 million in overall in funds. So if the government was slow and the state was slow in giving us our money, I mean, we wouldn't fall apart immediately.
Well, that's the point.
Oh,
we
okay.
have this, we should, one way to look at it is just to slash and burn and spend it all. I mean, almost to the point where you say, we're not going to levy taxes for a year mm-hmm. and just burn all the reserves so that they're down to zero, and then we have zero reserves so that we can't weather that type of storm or continue to do what we're doing now.
And those reserves are invested, right?
Yes.
And how are they invested?
They're invested in CDs. A couple of things that we look for. We look for FDIC insurance, so no bank holds more than $250,000, which is the limit of our of the insurance these days. And we have some government agency bonds, which are also out of applied policy. So, like the federal home loan.
Does provide additional revenue for our budget, right?
Yeah, last year, I believe we took in $67,000 of interest. Sounds very low. In previous years, it was more like $20,000 on higher levels. So we're using it the best we can. So limitations for the 2015 property tax levy. Increases to the tax levy or the aggregate extension, we talked about the difference between those terms in one of the first slides, are generally limited to the lesser 5% or the increase in the consumer price index, whichever is less in a given year applied to the prior year's aggregate extension base. So basically what that says is you have a tax levy for 2014, that 2014 tax levy can only increase by 5% or CPI, whichever is less, for the new tax. Okay. This year, the state tells you what CPI is. They publish a document, and this year they said that CPI for this purpose is 0.8%. Okay. Therefore, if you do the math, and we start with the aggregate extension, the 6.1 million that we talked about in the earlier slide, okay? We arrive at 6,192,352. There's a problem with the math. That last number, instead of 1.015, should be 1.08. Yeah, exactly. All right. However, in a year following a year when the taxing district had a decreased extension, which we did have last year, the aggregate extension base is the highest extension in the last three preceding years. Okay. In this case, the extension base is the 2012 property tax levy, or $7.1 million. Therefore, the limitation on the 2015 tax levy is $7.2 million, which is the 7.150 times the 100.8. I got the number right on this slide. And that number is $1.1 million greater than the 2014 aggregate extension. And I know that's some hard concepts, so I put together a slide which shows in the area upper left shows the tax levy year, what the aggregate extension was excluding the extension for the amount that was extended for the debt service when we had bonds outstanding. So it shows 6.8 million in 2010, going to 6.9, 7.150, 6.3, and then 6.1, which is the 2014 levy. Of course, the question mark is what we're trying to figure out. The blue arrow shows the 2014 tax levy, which decreased by $222,000 when compared to the 2013 levy. Therefore, it triggers this language where the aggregate extension base for the purpose of limiting the 2015 levy is equal to the highest of the three previous year's levies. So you pick the highest of 2012, 2013, or 2014, and then you see the green arrow pointing to 2012, which is the highest of those three numbers. So that's kind of how that language operates. So, here are some possible strategies for determining what the 2015 levy should be. I put four strategies together. One is, the first one on the left is further reduction of the tax levy. We've seen a reduction in the last 2 years, roughly $1 million and then $200,000 in separate steps. Zero change, just leave the levy flat. a slight increase or a significant increase. The future tax levies, as I state there, you'd only be able to grow it by the lesser of 5% of the increase in CPI, and again, the CPI increase is 0.8%. The library district, in that case, would lose ground, and its surplus would turn to a deficit pretty quickly, you know, as the taxes increase by 0.8% and the expenditures increase by 2.7%, you'd be losing ground at the rate of 1.9% a year. In all of these circumstances, you could further reduce the levy in the future. That's always open to us. Deficits in the further reduction scenario or strategy appear in 1 year. For the zero change strategy, 2 years, 4 years for a slight increase, and no deficits for a significant increase. We have a lot of unknowns that cut across all the strategies. I'm not any smarter on TIF whether the strategy is reduced or increased. I still don't know what the strategic planning outcomes would be or what the public service expansion might look like if, you know, if any of that is, what any of those numbers will look like until they actually come to fruition. Future considerations, further reduction would severely limit strategic choices. You'd kind of be forced into an area where you'd have to think very small, or maybe think about, you know, cutting deeply. Zero change would have some limitations to strategic choices, but not as severe as further reduction. Slight increase would give you limited freedom, and then of course a significant increase would give you the most freedom to consider strategic choices. So, you know, just to put some numbers to it, apropos of nothing, but just to, you know, try to, you know, create some sensitivity around it, I said, let's say the further reduction is $500,000. Zero change, obviously no change. The slight increase would be about $300,000, and a significant increase would be $1 million. Future property taxes, you know, 2016 and thereafter would be equal to what's levied in 2015, and the expenditures would continue to grow at 2.7%. So, plugging the numbers, this is what we get. And the way that this works is that these two lines here are what we saw earlier in the presentation. When we add them together, this becomes the zero change case, okay? So we start in 2015, 2016, when you combine the general fund and the special revenue funds with a surplus of $274,000. In 16-17, that's reduced to 118, and then it becomes a $42,000 deficit growing each year thereafter. Okay. In the further reduction case right here, the first year, because it only affects half of the year, is half of the reduction. So it would only impact 15-16 by $250,000, and then $500,000 per year afterwards. When I get to this point where I'm trying to predict the surplus or the deficit, the way that the math works is I take this 250 off the line above, the zero change case, and then these are the numbers that yield. So it's pretty much break even here in the first year to $1 million deficit in the out years. The slight increase of $300,000, again, we take half in the 15-16 fiscal year, then $300,000 even throughout. The way the math works here is this 150 comes off, or I'm sorry, is added to the zero change case, and that's how these numbers result. So you see that, you know, we look pretty healthy for a while, and then we get on that slippery slope, and by year five, we have a deficit. And then the significant increase of $1 million starts with $500,000 in the current fiscal year up to $1 million every year. And you can see we go And again, the math works, this number plus the numbers on the zero change case will yield the bottom line numbers here, and then you can see what they look like. So it's a lot of numbers. So I put together a graph. And you can see down here some of the legend is blocked, but you know the highest case.
This is for the general fund.
General and special revenue.
Combined.
Yes.
Okay.
You know this is the high case, the significant increase case, and then this is the further reduction case. You can see further reduction basically starts at break even and then gets down to a million, just like the numbers shown in the previous graph. And here it starts at a little over 500, it goes up, and then it comes back down to just below 500 in the out years. The different way of looking at it is if we take all of these numbers, okay, and add them up, okay? So what this is the cumulative results. So in the first year, it's whatever happens in 2015, 2016. In the second year here, it's whatever happened in 15, 16 added to whatever happens in 16, 17. So each further point on each graph here is an accumulation of the results of all the years prior. Okay, so what we're saying is in this case right here, $1 million increase by the end of 2021 gives us about $4.8 million in total if you add all of those surpluses together.
$1 million per year starting now, or $1 million in 2020?
It would be a $1 million increase in this model to the 2015 tax levy, which would give us an additional $500,000 this year.
So for the next 5 or 6 years,
yeah,
then we would see that.
Okay.
Okay.
And then the reduction case, here, shows, the addition of deficits and, leading down to, I don't know, 3.6 or 3.5 million dollars in total deficits. Okay. Now, what I did was I imposed another line, and I call this our strategic planning horizon. Apropos of nothing, I picked $2.5 million. You can make it $1 million, it'll shift the line down further. You can make it 500,000, you could, whatever you see fit, okay? And what the thinking is here is that we have some unknowns that we're trying to plan for, and some things that we're trying to do to make the library a better place. I don't know what those cost, okay? But at $2.5 million right here, what you can see is that the only strategy that gets you to that level is the significant increase strategy. Of course, there's additional. There's much more money in that strategy in the out years. Mm-hmm. But we're not making. I want to stress, and I'm sure you all know this. We're not making a 5-year decision now. We're making a 1-year decision, and this gets reviewed on an annual basis. So it's measured and remeasured and recalibrated and remodeled.
So technically,
and that's it.
My question is going to be technically at this point, where we're at right now, that would have been what, the brown one, the third one down? Which one would it have been if we stayed exactly where we are right now?
This one right here, the zero change
is it's red or brown?
Yeah, this line right here.
Okay, thank you.
Can I just ask one question? I'm sorry, were you finished?
Yeah.
Okay. You mentioned if we continue to increase spending at a rate of 2.7%, mm-hmm. These are the decreases we'll see, and then, of course, there's the strategic planning, which I think alluded to this Northwest quadrant. And then we all know that we're trying to develop some sort of pension or IMRF. What I'm trying to figure out is, you know, I'm always, and I know, thank you, this is incredibly difficult to put together and time-consuming, but I would like to know if there's also a way to look at this in terms of decreasing spending. I know you've heard me say corporations cut spending easily 5% a year. We're only going up 2.7%. There's no vision to cut, so we wouldn't have to levy and worry about 5 years down the road and the TIF kicking us out of the ballpark in terms of what we may be generating in revenues. I mean, we never consider cutting expenses. I mean, isn't that a possibility?
Sure it is. Sure it is. But I mean, that's, yeah, I think that's a decision that...
Okay, well, thank you, but I, and this is incredible.
Those are actions that you want to take from them, deal from them.
All right, thank you.
I have a question. Just looking at this and your description of the tax caps. Tax caps, of course, were designed to prevent local taxing bodies from raising their tax levy more than a certain amount. That limits the amount you can raise. But according to the laws you set forth in this PowerPoint, you can, when you're raising your levy, go back up to 3 years to choose some aggregate other than the one that's your past one.
Let me state it, okay? Only in the first year following a decrease from the previous year.
So we've decreased ours 2 years in a row.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay.
Last year was a decrease.
Right.
And so this is, what matters is last year's was a decrease.
All right.
And because last year was a decrease, we have the opportunity in the first year after that decrease to go back 3 years.
Okay, to 2012.
Yes.
Okay, all right. So if we needed to raise our levy and we wanted to use the 2012 aggregate, this is last year we can do it, right?
Yes, next year.
It would be too late.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Because we would be limited to, let's say, the CPI is 0.8% again, and we would be limited to 0.8% of the lower amount we had last year.
Right. Okay. And if we decrease it this year, you know, mm-hmm. then the first year after you can go back 3 years, but the 2012 year will have fallen out mm-hmm. because it'll be 4 years back.
Right. Okay.
And we'll go to the 2015 year.
When does this have to be decided? By?
December 9th.
Yeah, December 1st
December?
Is.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a couple of operational things to consider. Do you want to?
I think we'll have to have a special meeting for you guys to vote on the levy. And depending on what you decide, either if you go over a certain amount, we will have to have a public hearing, a truth and taxation hearing, is that what it's called?
Yes.
Yeah, a truth and taxation notice of public hearing, and that would have to come sometime between, it's tricky to figure out, it's like the notice of it would have to be between November 17th and November 24th, not more than 14 days nor less than 7 days before the hearing, but it has to basically be decided by December 1st, because that is the first Tuesday in December.
So the special
meeting you'd have to have a truth and taxation period before you adopted the final budget.
Yeah,
you increase the levy by 5%.
So there's
5% or more.
Yeah.
We mean 5% over last year,
right.
Or 5% over
last year.
I mean, we can't do it over. Okay.
Over last year. So there's three things we got to do. Two things definitely, maybe three. Okay. First thing we have to do is determine the amount of the levy. Okay. The second thing that we need to do is to measure that determination compared to last year's levy. And see if we're more than 5% or more greater than last year's levy. If we're more than 5% greater, then we have to have a deal. If we're not, then it's pretty easy. We could vote to adopt the levy that's 104.99% or whatever. If we have the, if it's more than 5% or more, then we have to have the hearing, and then after the hearing, we adopt, the board adopts the levy.
So according to this that you've got up here?
Yes.
Which one would be your 5% or your less than 5%? The gray one?
The second line down, that's the slight increase case.
Okay, so the one I asked before, the zero one that you called it, the one that's kind of brown
and
red?
This is the zero case.
Yeah.
This is going up 300,000. Now, if you think about it, you know, 5% of 6.1 million is a little bit more than 300,000. So I picked that number because it's below. Yeah.
Okay.
And then, you know, this is the much higher case.
That's the much higher. So, okay. At least seeing it, it gives us a little bit better idea. Yeah. Okay. Thank you for that.
Greg, if we did nothing, what happened? Why would we need to levy? We have cash on hand. Why do we need to levy right now? We're not running out of funds.
It's a legal timetable
to raise it. I'm saying based on your expenses. I mean, do we need to, you know, jump into strategic planning to increase more, you know, facilities in the Northwest Quadrant? Shouldn't we, like, think about this?
Well, I think that's what the planning process is. But
the planning process to spend. How about the planning process to rethink it?
If we don't levy taxes, then I have no money coming in after the end of 2015. I have no property taxes. You have to levy taxes.
And we have to do that by a statutory date. We have no choices.
You have no money coming in. Why?
You have to adopt your tax levy if you're going to adopt one by the first Tuesday in December.
Right, then I know. Why do we need to adopt? Why do we
Because
need
you won't have, it's your only source of income, really. If you don't adopt a tax levy, you're not going to get any tax dollars.
But do we need an increase of $1 million? Do we need an increase?
I was only presenting cases.
Okay. So that's
you can see what the curves look like.
That's our discussion.
I don't know what the board.
That's our discussion. Yeah, I was just presenting the different options.
I'm trying to figure out the need to increase the levy. If there's no need, why are we even having this discussion? I mean, it's nice to get more money.
I think that's what the strategic planning, I mean, what the PowerPoint shows. I mean, Greg, a number of reasons why we might need more income, why our levy might be going down for other, why we might be losing income for other reasons, such as the TIF. So I think there's a number of reasons outlined in there why we might need to levy more funds. And also there's a separate discussion about the special reserve funds, which we consciously made a decision several years ago to spend those down because we had fairly high balances at that time. And we made a conscious decision that we were going to spend those down knowing that we would at some point have to start putting money in those funds again, and that time has come. Mm-hmm.
But once again, we just talk about spending. We don't talk about cutting costs. I mean, come on. And if we're worried about not getting as much in taxes, we're not talking about being, you know, outstretched by $1 million. It's 50 grand, 300,000. These aren't numbers we can't deal with. It's what I'm trying to understand, why we have to jump into a levy increase. Because when you look at the possibilities of not getting all the revenues we usually get, initially, we're not going to be devastated.
Well, Carolyn, I also presented a property tax reduction case. You know, so I try to present cases.
No, and I'm not saying that you didn't.
Across the spectrum, mm-hmm, to show you what the curves look like. Mm-hmm. You know, if the board is of a mind that we're going to stand pat on exactly what we have, then you're probably right. There probably is no reason to, you know, consider an increase in the levy or increase in anything. We could even reduce it and we can, you know, cut back on a lot of expenses and stuff. I mean,
well,
at some point you handicap your operations, and
I know, but I don't think we're at that point, but anyway, thank you, I appreciate it.
Well, you know, look at the one that's for zero. It's really not, doesn't look like it's that much different than the one that's, where you're raising it less than 5%. I mean, they're not, there is a difference, but they're pretty close compared to the one for a million, which I personally don't see the necessity to make myself, like going to a million at this point. That's me. I mean, why should we want to raise taxes that much at this point? I don't see, you know, when we do, you know, like she said, we have, there are things we can do.
Can we get a copy? Can you, is this too big to send to us?
No. I'll just read it.
Okay, so should we go to the unfinished business?
Well, I think you do need to decide, I mean, this has to be decided before the next board meeting.
There has to be an estimate of taxes that are going to be levied before you make determinations to whether or not you need to have truth of taxation.
Can we have a special board meeting and think about it?
You can.
Yeah.
And I was going to propose possibly making it November 5th, since that's a date that's already set for the Buildings and Grounds Committee, so that we know that some of the people are available. So if you wanted to check.
Sure, that's fine.
Good idea.
Good idea.
Sounds good. Since we already have a date planned.
I'm very hard with that.
All right, we have that on the calendar.
Well, I figured I should be on some committee. That's as good as any.
It's the idea, when we adopt the tax levy, remember, it's a lateral way. Because it has to be done.
Well, the adoption has to be in November, because the filing date's on.
Yeah.
It has to be before, so it's got to be.
Like you do a special meeting.
At the regular November meeting would be the.
So are we going to have enough time for the publishers and to conduct it before?
Yes, but only if we do, if we pay to sign up that November 5th meeting. November 6th meeting.
Greg?
Yes.
I understand what you said. To a certain.
Excuse me, hey guys, I'm trying to field the question.
I understand what you said to a certain degree. My question is, okay, you're going back to 12. Does it have to be the exact amount of 12, or can it be a little less than that?
It's a cap.
Or do we have, okay.
It's a cap.
So this is the most we could possibly do it?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Just giving you your options.
Giving you, okay. I was just curious, because the way I'm understanding it, it was like, this is the amount, but it's not. We can be, we can bring it down from that if we wanted to.
You can do anything that you want, just, you know, the numbers are just illustrative, you know, so that, you know, you kind of see where it puts you and.
Okay.
How you, I think it's clear, but just let me reiterate. How much you levy is going to impact how much your extension is, which is going to affect in the future how much you can levy in the future. So today, this year impacts what you're going to be able to do next year and the year after that.
And realistically, like you're saying, there might be a roof for unexpected things that come up that are going to.
Well, we've tried to do a lot of that, you know, think of a lot of that. That's why we have 1.8 million in the special reserve fund. But what we're talking about here is, you know, the impact of, you know, strategic planning and, you know, and what those outputs might look like. Obviously, the more money you have, the more flexibility and the larger your solution set is in terms of what you want to accomplish. Accomplish as a board or, you know, as a library or whatever.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I'll leave this sort of.
Yeah.
Yes, thank you.
Can we do this? Can we do this as a special one or no? I think it goes away.
Good, but
it'll be too much.
You can focus your attention on it.
Okay.
So now, for this special meeting, this meeting you had originally planned for the
Buildings and Grounds?
Grounds Committee. This would be mostly, nothing pertaining to the Grounds Committee then, that'll be in the future, and this will be just to discuss this levy.
I think you can start with.
Potentially, yeah, I mean, if the levy discussion goes on for 2 hours, then no, we will probably cancel the buildings and grounds.
Yeah, I think it's good for the levy.
It doesn't build in.
Yeah, it's an open meeting.
Yes.
Yeah, say, well, it'll all be open.
Both of them up for the same day, different times.
Yep, right.
If you have more than two people, doesn't have to be an open.
It will be.
Oh, lovely.
It will be, it will be an open meeting.
I mean.
Sure.
Okay.
I'd like to just go around and see, do we want to continue with the unfinished business, or do we want to hold off? Let's just go around, so I'm not making this decision, we can just make it all together. Go ahead.
It's almost 10 o'clock. I don't see any urgency in changing these policies tonight, I could be wrong, and.
No, I have time, that's the plus one.
Okay.
It would be nice, but do it with a clear cut.
Yeah.
I'm fine with putting it off, if everybody else is fine with it.
Okay, yeah, I agree too, it's getting late, and some of you have to go far to go home, we at least look close, but I know, no one else doesn't.
So why don't you entertain a motion to table items 13A to the next regular board session?
Okay.
I second it, table, I second it.
To the next.
Okay, 13 to the regular. November.
So there was Karen and Patty?
Yes, ma'am.
Excuse me, are we tabling just 13, or the rest of the agenda?
13 for now.
Oh, are we gonna, oh, then we're moving on to 14 now?
So we're starting from 13A.
Yeah, 13, 14, did you do that?
Oh, good, so we're tabling.
Yeah, we're tabling everything.
Oh, thank you, I thought we were gonna sit for something.
No, not that. 17.
I thought we were just 13.
We're not tabling 17.
Okay.
13 through 16.
Right, yes.
Okay, that's fine too, I'll make that motion. Where did I put that person?
To the next regular board meeting.
It's number 13.
It's up here someplace.
It's Karen and Patty. Is there any discussion on tabling 13, 14, 15, and 16? Okay, we have a roll call.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yes.
Oh, sorry, she left. Patty?
Yes.
Yes. So, motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn, second.
Okay, Patty.
Karen?
I'll say aye.
Yes.
Aye.
Aye.